barely 2 months into 2020, and as countries grapple to contain the coronavirus pandemic, we saw an unprecedented disruption of the global supply chain, with most countries implementing varying levels of lockdown and quarantine measures. Manufacturers and suppliers had very limited operations, with their raw materials and supply source unable to reach their factories and shops, with a temporary embargo on freight and logistics. In some cases, for the first time, to procure personal protective equipment and related supplies. What used to be a procurement project undertaken by hospitals and allied medical offices is now trusted upon most government procurement practitioners. This poses a huge risk to the quality of procurement as procuring entities scramble to buy in large quantities in the fastest time possible, but with asymmetrical or limited market information. Moreover, with the community quarantine being imposed in most parts of the country, particularly in urban areas, a number of prospective bidders were unable to physically submit or attend pre-bid conference and opening of bids, resulting in a number of cancelled or even failed biddings. And with telecommuting being implemented in most government agencies, the conduct of procurement activities was made even more challenging given the unreliable internet connection, traditional paper-based records keeping, and with some official documents requiring handwritten signatures for processing, all of which compounded the already difficult and complex work of government procurement practitioners. Emergency procurement in times of crisis inevitably opens door for inefficient acquisitions by people under severe time pressure, for some unintentionally, but others occurring as a result of corruption. As we have seen other countries struggle in the response to the pandemic, the Philippines, through the Government Procurement Policy Board Technical Support Office, foresaw the need to anticipate procurement constraints given the grave and possibly prolonged effects of the coronavirus pandemic. As early as March 9, 2020, the GPPB met and issued Resolution Number 03-2020, adopting efficient, effective, and expedient procurement procedures during a state of public health emergency. As shown here, negotiated procurement under emergency cases can now be undertaken with four simple steps. This was made possible with the streamlining of the existing procedure being undertaken. Thus, the rules now dispense with the requirement of a written confirmation from the head of the procuring entity of the existence and veracity of the grounds relied upon. The board likewise expressly included the instances or situations where emergency procurement may be applied, such as the provision of immediate response and initial recovery steps to avoid loss of life, injury, disease, and other negative effects on human physical, mental, and social well-being, together with damage to property, destruction of assets, loss of services, social and economic disruption, and environmental degradation, as well as the lease of real property or venue for use as quarantine centers, evacuation sites, medical relief and aid distribution, locations, warehousing facilities, or similar temporary disaster or emergency response facility. This enabled procuring entities to readily adopt emergency procurement for the purchase of COVID-19 related items. Upon the declaration of a state of public health emergency by the President, the GPPB Technical Support Office immediately coordinated with the Department of Health and the Procurement Service to identify items that will be needed by most agencies so they can be included in the list of common use supplies and equipment which the Procurement Service can buy in bulk and take advantage of economies of scale. This includes alcohol, sanitizers, thermometers, personal protective equipment, gloves, mass testing kits, among others. Agencies can then readily purchase these items from the procurement service when available, giving them more time to focus on other equally important tasks. And when Congress passed the Bayanihan to Heal as One Act, the GPPB immediately issued the Bayanihan Procurement Rules, which included a provision on direct purchase from local farmers. The board likewise simplified the documentary requirements for this modality. Accordingly, procuring entities intending to directly buy from a local farmer need only to ask a submission of any of the following: a certification from the Department of Agriculture that the farmer is in the registry system for basic sectors in agriculture, or RSBSA, or his RSBSA identification card, or a barangay certification that he is a bona fide farmer. B also approved the adoption and use of simplified PBDs, or public bidding documents for goods and infrastructure projects, or the 6th edition PBDs. This was done to Resolution Number 15-2020, dated July 28, 2020.
That would be the primary document.
Yeah. I think now right now is 20 pages. At least kung we set all of the rules and the guidelines inside, hapo siya sa website, we have to replicate it in the video. So just limit it to several pages para ma-minimize natin ang failure.
It may be noted that the PBDs for the procurement of goods have been reduced to 40 pages from the original 112 pages, while infrastructure projects went down to 35 pages from the original of 113 pages. The GPPB came up with a simplified version of the previous edition to address the confusion and varied interpretations of the procuring entities and bidders on the clauses of the 5th edition PBDs, in relation to the provision of RA 9184 and associated issuances. The sheer volume of the previous PBDs and resulting confusion and differing interpretation caused a significant number of disqualification and ultimately failure of biddings. With the simplified PBDs and its accompanying circular, procuring entities are easily guided by the standard rules in the use of the PBDs, which uses clear and simple language. The simplification of the PBDs came after 4 grueling months of studying the repeated queries posed by procuring entities in the use of the PBDs, as well as reviewing the common causes of disqualification and conducting a series of consultation with procuring entities, before the same was made effective last October 6, 2020. The GPPB TSO likewise held an online unboxing event last September 21, 2020, together with the Secretary Avisado, followed by a webinar to discuss the contents of the PBDs and address clarificatory questions. The simplification of the PBDs is but the first step in streamlining the conduct of public procurement. The GPPB Technical Support Office is now in the beta testing stage of the online PBD Builder. This is a web-based online facility that will assist procuring entities in preparing their PBDs. With a simple click of a button, procuring entities need only to encode the details of their procurement projects, choose from drop-down options, and upload the bidding documents when finished. That is all there is to it. No more errors, no more confusion, no more double-checking of updated forms, no more repetitive downloading of files. We hope to launch this online facility soon, so check out for this. For the first time, the Commission on Audit and the GPPB issued a joint memorandum circular last March 26, 2020, expressly providing that during the state of public health emergency declared by the President, procuring entities are allowed to resort to negotiated procurement emergency cases for the procurement of goods, infrastructure projects, and consulting services that are directly related to the mitigation and containment of the transmission of COVID-19 in order for procuring entities to properly and timely respond to this public health emergency. This joint issuance by the COA and the GPPB provided confidence to procuring entities which have been risk-averse in the use of emergency procurement for fear of COA observation or disallowance. In consideration of the limited access to financial institutions, regulatory and other offices, as well as the implementation of government restrictions on transport and travel, the GPPB allowed procuring entities to accept alternate documentary requirements for procurement activities undertaken during a state of calamity or during the implementation of community quarantine or similar restrictions declared or being implemented either in the locality of the procuring entity or of the bidder. This includes a notarized bid securing declaration, expired business or mayor's permit with official receipt of renewal application, a notarized omnibus sworn statement, and performance securing declaration, in lieu of a performance security to guarantee the winning bidder's faithful performance of obligations under the contract. All of which are subject to compliance with the lacking requirement after award of contract but before payment. And with the birth of a totally different procurement ecosystem resulting from this pandemic, the GPPB reminded procuring entities on the use of video conferencing and other digital technologies, which was authorized way back in 2018. This will be used in the conduct of procurement activities such as pre-bid conference, opening of bids, and post-qualification activities. The board also allowed the suspension of procurement activities beginning March 9, 2020, following the declaration by the President of a state of public health emergency throughout the Philippines, subject to the determination by the BAC of the existence of any of the grounds for suspension of the conduct of procurement activities. This includes subsequent tolling of the periods for the procurement projects covered by the suspension, including the running of the 3-month period to award the contract and terminate the procurement process under Section 38 of Republic Act No. 9184. The board, mindful of the concerns in the issuance of the CNES or the Certificate of Non-Availability of Stocks for common use supplies and equipment not available with the PS, has come up with an innovative way to enable procuring entities to procure the same elsewhere without securing a CNES. Thus, procuring entities need only to keep a record of the proof of unavailability of the CSE as shown in the PS website, such as a printed form of the webpage or a screenshot of the same showing the date and time that it was accessed. The GPPB TSO, even prior to the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, has been issuing anticipatory non-policy matter opinions to readily guide procuring entities in the conduct of their procurement projects and address frequently asked questions. This has proven to be useful in providing immediate relief to procuring entities who are in need of clarifications in their interpretation of rules, especially under a work-from-home arrangement. For smart and efficient conduct of BAC activities, the GPPB as early as 2018 has authorized virtual meetings of the Bids and Awards Committee. And in 2019, it encouraged the use of digital signature in all procurement-related documents. While the uptick was a bit slow when these were authorized, it dramatically changed with the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic this year, making virtual meetings and the use of digital signature very much a staple in the new normal. The COVID-19 pandemic accelerated many of our digital transformation initiatives, among which is the mandatory electronic submission of procurement reports and our ongoing automation efforts, all aimed at establishing a structured data management system crucial in providing evidence-based policy recommendations to the GPPB and for a meaningful and timely procurement monitoring. This year, we also started with the use of data analytics in extending interim procurement diagnostics to pilot agencies. To complete the online transformation in the conduct of public procurement, the GPPB has authorized electronic and online bid submission. Any form of electronic submission that carries a two-factor security procedure may be used for the submission of bids to ensure the security, integrity, and confidentiality thereof. Currently, there are 161 procuring entities already using electronic bid submission. As for the online bid submission, the GPPB TSO, with the help of the United States Agency for International Development, is working on a web-based online bid submission portal that procuring entities may employ in addition to or in place of the manual bid submission. This online facility is a transitional platform to address the challenges brought by this pandemic as the PhilJEPS is in the process of completing its modernization efforts. Once again, with the technical assistance from the United States Agency for International Development or USAID, the GPPB TSO was able to launch and utilize the GPPB online portal, ensuring greater transparency and accountability for procurements conducted pursuant to the Bayanihan to Heal as One Act. Given the posting limitations of the field trips, the GPPB TSO sought the help of USAID to develop this portal and provide the digital space for procuring entities to post all of their awarded contracts pursuant to the Bayanihan Act. We are currently finalizing the data analytics of the buying patterns of the government, both national and local, in response to this pandemic. Contract and supplier details are likewise available online without need for registration. Just go to our website at www.gppb.gov.ph and look for the icon GPPB Online Portal. Indeed, public accountability can never be sacrificed over expediency, even in times of crisis. By providing an open and inclusive digital space through the GPPB Online Portal, we are able to spot questionable procurement projects and call on procuring entities to account for their actions. On the other hand, the GPPB Online Blacklisting Portal is an in-house developed platform by our very own Information Management Division in the GPPB Technical Support Office. It was developed primarily to ensure timely, accurate, and complete information on blacklisted entities. The OBP, as we call it, has an automatic notification feature to the field GEPs for blacklisted entities suspended by a procuring entity. This signals the field GEPs to cancel the registration of the blacklisted supplier for the covered period. This will then prevent the award of contracts by other procuring entities to the said blacklisted supplier. Secondly, and this is why the development of the OBP was accelerated, to complement the virtual conduct of post-qualification proceedings in light of the health safety protocols being imposed all over the country. Procuring entities and the public in general can now readily access the Consolidated Blacklisting Report online through the GPPB website. Just look for the OBP icon. And because transparency in procurement also means empowering stakeholders with accurate and timely information through effective and innovative channels in order to bridge the gap on access to information brought about by this pandemic, the GPPB TSO can now be reached through Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Just look for Government Procurement PH. To complement this, we have likewise been using information education and communication materials such as infographics as well as audiovisual presentations on our website and social media pages. Beginning April of this year, we have shifted to digital learning with the conduct of and participation in webinars, online trainings, online ugnayan, and with the launch of our digital learning series. With more than 30 online training programs and webinars, participated by almost 5,000 procurement practitioners, suppliers, and CSO representatives, and joined online by more than 126,000 Facebook viewers, we were able to effectively disseminate the changes and enhancements implemented to assist procuring entities in their procurement activities.